Hello, in this lecture, I'm going to be talking about sedimentary rocks, including where they're forming and how to identify them. So, sedimentary rocks form from the weathering of pre-existing rocks. So, it can be igneous rocks, sedimentary rocks, or metamorphic rocks. And as we break down those particles, they're then transported from where they originally formed, they're deposited, and then they're lithified through a process of compaction. They're very important because they help us decipher the Earth's history. They're a very important source of where we find many of our resources. So, all of our petroleum deposits are stored in sedimentary rocks. And we use them a lot for building stone. I think that they're pretty cool because when we go and we start to think about all the rocks that we see on the Earth's surface, you have two different graphs here. Sedimentary rocks make up only 4% of the Earth's crust, but when you go out and you start to look at the landscape around you, sedimentary rocks make up 75% of the rocks that you see at the Earth's surface, and that's because they're forming right at the Earth's surface. And again, the crust is very, very thick. So they're an important thing to get to know because you will see them a lot. They help us understand the Earth's history and they're pretty cool. They're my favorite type of rocks, I must admit. When we talk about sedimentary rocks, we break them into two major types. We have clastic sedimentary rocks. These are made of detrital sediments or clasts. So they're solid particles of other rocks. And again, it can be any type of other rock. Igneous, metamorphic, or sedimentary rocks can all become sediment that make up these clastic rocks. We also have chemical or biochemical sediments. So these are precipitated sediments. They're often considered crystalline because they're precipitating out of water, either by just chemical processes or biochemical processes because an organism is making it. I'm going to talk about both next. So clastic sedimentary rocks, these form because we start to make sediment. So here we're looking at the mountains. As you can imagine, wind, rain, blowing, starting to break the rocks that make up these mountains around. Okay, that's going to create sediment. That sediment gets deposited by wind, by water. It drops down into a basin. That sediment starts to accumulate, and over time, the sediments, when more are added on top, they get compacted, they get closer and closer together, until then later, water that's holding other elements will start to flow through that rock, and it starts to glue those particles together because mineral crystals will start to precipitate out of the water, and it acts as a glue to crystallize and hold those clasts together. The three major types of sediments that we see are calcite, which is calcium carbonate. It will dissolve if acid's put on it. We see silica, which is a very strong cement. That's SiO2. It's very similar to quartz. And then we also see hematite, our iron oxide cement. So this will give, as it's exposed to oxygen, whether in water or air, it will start to oxidize and turn red. It rusts. And so those are our iron oxide cements. Okay, so three common ones to look for and kind of how to tell them apart. Clastic sedimentary rocks are classified by their clast size and the shape. So this table up here, I know I'm blocking it, I apologize for that, but we can look overall at the size. If it's greater than 2 millimeters and it's rounded, it's conglomerate. If it's angular, it's breccia. Sands become sandstone, so those are particles between 2 and 1/16 of a millimeter. Silts become siltstones, and anything that's less than 1/256th of a millimeter is a clay-sized particle, and you can either get clay stones or, if you see layers, shale. I'm going to show some examples of each and try to point things out in your lab kit. So if you pick up sample, let me try to get organized here. Sample 29 has a nice example of larger particle sizes. Okay, so these are over 2 millimeter in diameter. And if you look at yours and you see rounded particles, you're actually looking at a conglomerate. So these conglomerates form fairly close to their source. They're associated with things like streams. What we're looking at here is a dry stream bed. We see some very large particles. If you can imagine suddenly burying all this sediment, compacting it, and lithifying it, we would form conglomerates. So they're often very much associated with stream bed deposits and near source. So we can see the mountains in the background if you're looking for the source where this is all coming from. And then again, as the water's tumbling, these particles, they chip and they become rounded. We also see some very large particles that are angular. So these are often associated with glaciers. Glaciers, they pick up sediment and they move it without really tumbling the particles. So we start to see more angular particles. Volcanoes can blow things out. They'll become very angular, and if they're suddenly lithified, we can see some volcanic breccias. This would be, we're looking here, this is a moraine deposit down in the Cordillera Blanca. So this is one very large clast. This could be as big as a car or a house. And then we see other particles here. If we could bury and lithify this right away, we could form the sedimentary rock that we see here, which would be a breccia. Okay, sandstones are those particles that we can still see with our eyes. So they are less than 2 millimeters in size and greater than 1/16 of a millimeter. When you look at it, a good example would be sample 33 in your box. If you look very closely at that with your hand lens, you'll actually start to see little rounded particles that are then cemented together with a cement. This is a good example of a quartz sandstone. So the particles are little grains of sandstone, quartz. That have been rounded. And we tend to see sandstones forming on beaches and then also in our desert environment. So as wind picks up these particles, they get weathered down and rolled into these sand-sized grains. All right, shales are the next size. So these are the ones that are smaller than sands. They are greater. They are kind of fine grain when we're looking at them. So they're less than 1/256 of a millimeter. They're very fine grain and they're harder to tell apart. If you have a rock sample that you can kind of break apart a little bit, and you might want to look at your sample 34. If you start to kind of rub it off, you can put some of that, see my fingers, it's dirty. You can put some of that on your teeth and then lick it with your tongue. Or even lick your finger and then rub your teeth. If it feels generally smooth, what you have are clay-sized particles. If you feel grittiness, and you could imagine chomping your teeth, apologize if this is grossing anybody out, but what you're telling is that your tongue is very sensitive to particle size. If it feels gritty, it would be a silt, so it's coarser grained. If it feels fine grained, it's going to be those clay-sized particles, and then we'd classify it as either a mudstone or a shale. If you see layers within your sample, so really strong layers, we're going to call that a shale. If it's just very fine grained but sort of massive, we call it a mudstone. When we have these fine-grained particles, it tells us that the area of deposition was very quiet. It's associated with swamps, lagoons, the deep oceans, places where there's not a lot of current to stir things up or carry those heavier particles. Particle size tells us about transportation because it takes a lot of energy to move big things. It doesn't take a lot of energy to move a small clay-sized particle. They can be carried by wind or by water very long distances. And then the image we have here shows shale showing a nice, lovely fossil impression. These are fern leaves. All right. There are many features of sedimentary rocks that we can pay attention to. Bedding are just the layers that we see inside of sedimentary rocks, and we can start to go back through time when we see a nice original sequence of rocks, and we can start to interpret the layers. In the Grand Canyon, what we see here, the youngest rocks are on the top and the oldest rocks are on the bottom. Depending what we see inside of those layers can tell us about that history. Okay, ripple marks are undulations that we see inside of our sedimentary rocks, and they can be stored inside some of the rocks as well. If the surface that we're seeing here, this is in a along a beach, if that could be buried, we would actually see it forming and crystal forming and becoming preserved inside of those sedimentary rocks. It just tells us that we had some motion of water, whether by wind or water. So they are common in deserts. They're also common in water environments, streams, and beaches. We can see larger versions of ripples. They're called crossbeds, and this is where dunes start to move across. As that dune moves, sand goes up one side, slides down the other, and it creates these bedding that we can see. We're looking at Checkerboard Mesa in Utah, and you can actually see those large crossbeds. This just tells us that sand dunes were once moving across this area. The dunes became buried, compacted, turned into sandstone, and then are preserved. Mud cracks are another really cool feature that we see in some of our sedimentary rocks, it tells us that we had fine grain sediments that were wet and then dried over a period of time. And then as that mud starts to dry, it actually breaks apart to create these divisions. When I was little, we used to call these crunchies. We'd go and run out on dried mud and crunch them under our feet. But if you were to imagine burying this over time, fine sediment fills in the cracks and then that gets preserved. And we can see that in this large rock up here. Okay, so it tells us exposure to air. The other type of sedimentary rock that we have are our chemical sedimentary rocks. These form either by precipitation directly from water, which is a chemical origin, or by organisms that are precipitating that mineral through making a shell. Okay, so that's a biochemical origin. We do classify our sedimentary rocks using composition and texture. So this is the composition, the mineral that it's made of, or in this case, organic material, and then the texture that it has. I'm going to walk through a couple individually. Crystalline limestone is one where we don't see any fossils and we tend to see small crystal grains. They kind of come together and they're very shiny. We see these in some of our cave deposits, like this stalactite up here, and in the background. So this is from Cave of the Mounds. All right, they can also be precipitating in places where there's standing water that's enriched with calcium and carbonate. As it's overly enriched, it will start to precipitate out. Fossiliferous limestone is that which is formed from the shells of marine organisms. So clam shells, like we see here, brachiopods, corals. We're looking at a nice coral reef here. This, if we could bury this reef, would form and create a fossiliferous limestone. When we see those fossils, it tells us a lot about who was living at what time, what was going on. It gives us an idea. Marine, warm, shallow water. Think the Bahamas. Who doesn't want to think about the Bahamas? But anyway, that gives us a sense of where those fossil limestones are. Okay, coquinas are made from broken shells that have been cemented together. These happen in places where we are close to a reef, but pieces and particles are getting picked up by waves and then bashed together. And then those broken shells kind of form a sediment and then they get compacted and re-cemented together. So if we're looking at a view of a reef and we have the reef on the outside, these coquinas can be forming on the inside after the waves have washed over that reef, broken them up, and then deposited them down. Okay, chalk, we're looking at the White Cliffs of Dover in the background and a picture of a lovely foraminifera. This is a very tiny microorganism, lives out in the ocean and it makes its shell, these little bulbs that we see here are made out of calcium and carbonate. As that grows, it's pulling out calcium and carbonate from the water to make its shell. When it dies, it sinks to the bottom of the ocean, and a lot of them, if you pile them all up, they will become cemented together to create chalk. Very fine grain, but calcium carbonate sediment. Chert is another type of chemical sedimentary rock. This one is definitely chemical, not biochemical, and it forms when you have groundwater that's enriched in silicon oxygen moving through a rock. It comes into an opening and then starts to precipitate this microcrystalline quartz, and it grows in concentric layers until it fills the cavity. So that creates chert, and it can be many, many different colors. And you'll notice it does have conchoidal fracture, and it's very hard, just like quartz. Okay, rock gypsum is one that forms in evaporite conditions. What we're looking at here is in the desert, and this is where gypsum blades have been growing up. As the water that was standing in this area dried, that rock gypsum started to crystallize and create these bladed crystals, and the area in between is all of the clay minerals that are left behind, kind of the big flat pans. Rock gypsum, just like the gypsum in your kit, is going to be very soft. You can scratch it with your fingernail. Gives us an idea of an evaporite condition. Rock salt is another evaporite chemical rock that we see. This is your halite. We're looking at the Bonneville salt flats. What happens is water is flowing off of these mountains. It accumulates in these flat playas, these flat open deserts. The water evaporates. It leaves the salts behind that crystallize into halite. And in the last scene, the gypsum that we see. Coal is another chemical sedimentary rock that we see. This forms from organic plant material. So take your sample 28. This is your peat. As these plants die, they become compacted, they get buried, they do start to form into lignites. Those can then get compacted even more to become bituminous coal, which is your sample 27. If they get heated and metamorphosed, they will become sample 36, which is actually metamorphic. This is anthracite coal, and we'll talk about that later. So anyway, that's how your sedimentary rocks are classified. A little bit about them. Post your questions to the I Need Help.